Brazen, an imprint of Octopus Publishing Group Limited, presents Forgotten Women. Written by Zing Tsjeng and read by Jacqui Bardelang.
This text explores the themes of racial prejudices in historical context and includes some language, reported from the period, which was once commonplace in society, but which some listeners might now find offensive. Introduction. A confession. When I first wrote the Forgotten Women series 5 years ago, I rather hoped the title would soon become irrelevant. I wished that the 190 or so lives compiled in the 4 books, spanning leaders, writers, scientists, and artists, would become so well known that people picking up a copy might flip through and wrinkle their nose. What? She's in this? But she's so famous. I didn't think that might happen solely as a result of the series, though, of course, that's what every author dreams for their work. Just that the sheer momentum of time and progress might manifest a future where my books would be thought of as a quaint product of its time. A bygone age when women weren't considered to be important, powerful, or worth remembering. Sadly, that hasn't happened yet. But there are encouraging shoots of growth poking through. The ferocious 19th century Chinese pirate queen Qing Shi starred in an episode of Doctor Who, prompting a wave of interest in her past. The story of the Radium Girls, who fought for the right to a safe workplace after they were poisoned by radium at theirs, was turned into a feature film. LGBTQI+ activist Sylvia Rivera has been embraced as a trans rights icon whose face and name adorns Pride t-shirts and placards alike. And as I write, Tate Britain is planning a retrospective of the mystical Swedish painter Hilma af Klint, which will see her take her rightful place next to Pierre Mondrian, with a biopic of her life set to hit cinemas as well. But we've also seen huge backward strides for women's rights and equality. In the US, Roe v. Wade has been overturned, marking an end to universal access to abortion across all states. The pandemic, once spoken of as the Great Leveler, only served to worsen and entrench injustice, with women more likely to be made redundant even as they carried the burden of homeschooling and childcare. This is all taking place against the backdrop of the unfolding climate crisis, a slow-burn catastrophe that the UN believes will disproportionately affect women. It's easy to feel discouraged or even nihilistic. I've certainly felt that way at times too. But I don't believe the world has the patience for cynicism. It only offers space for action. That's what the stories of the women in this book all have in common. Where lesser beings might have prevaricated or procrastinated, despaired or felt discouraged, or simply given up, they didn't. They might have given in to momentary bouts of anguish, and there's nobody who writes anguish better than the Mexican poet and nun, Sor Juana Inés de la Cruz. But they simply did something when others might not. In many ways, that is all life is. A series of tiny actions leading up to something. A book, a painting, a poem, an experiment, a protest, an action that takes on the momentum of a forward roll. That book becomes a trailblazing treatise. That painting becomes a radical new mode of self-expression. That protest becomes a full-blown revolution. After all, the word movement suggests as much. And all you need to create that momentum is a little push. A tiny spark of inspiration. Whoever you are, I hope the stories in this book serve that function. It's that nudge in your side, the pebble in your shoe, the hand proffered in a dizzying crowd of people, tugging you forwards. The destination, of course, is entirely up to you. Chapter 1. Campaigners. Fighting for social change. Jane Anger. For centuries, women were told that rage is unbecoming. That to lose one's temper is to become a hag, a nag, a bitch, or all three. The ancient Greek playwright Euripides pretty much summed up the prevailing wisdom of the age when he put these words in a female character's mouth in Andromache. No man ever yet hath discovered aught to cure a woman's venom, which is far worse than viper's sting or scorching flame, so terrible a curse are we to mankind. But towards the tail end of the 16th century, a remarkable English essayist, Jane Anger, circa 1560 to circa 1600, emerged from the Elizabethan age, and the pamphlet she produced in 1589 was a pure and undistilled scream of rage. In the opening pages of Jane Anger, Her Protection for Women, to defend them against the scandalous reports, she greets her readers and gets down to business. Fie on the falsehood of men, whose minds go oft a-madding, and whose tongues cannot so soon be wagging, but straight they fall a-railing. Was there ever any so abused, so slandered, so railed upon, or so wickedly handled undeservedly, as are we women? With these words, Jane launched into a full-blown treatise on gender inequality, railing against the wickedness of men and their moral hypocrisy. She didn't bother with disguising the fact that her writing was fueled by righteous indignation. Shall not anger stretch the veins of her brains, the strings of her fingers, and the lists of her modesty to answer their surfeitings? Jane asks rhetorically, before answering her own question. Yes, truly. The Elizabethan age frequently saw men writing pamphlets to propose, spread, and denounce new ideas and philosophies. Or, in the case of the male writer who inspired Jane's outrage, to make a dig at women. Her Protection for Women is thought to be the first known work in English to defend the female gender, and Jane among the first major female polemicists writing in the English language. They suppose that there is not one amongst us who can or dare reprove their slanders and false reproaches. Their slanderous tongues are so short, and the time wherein they have lavished out their words freely hath been so long that they know we cannot catch hold of them to pull them out, and they think we will not write to reprove their lying lips, Jane sneers. In other words, guess what, buddy? You've met your match. It is thought that Jane's tract may have been written in response to a pamphlet called Book His Surfeit in Love, printed by a publisher known as Thomas Orwin. All copies of this work have been lost, but it's easy enough to guess some of its subject matter from Jane's own responses. On women's apparent lustfulness, she writes, "If we clothe ourselves in sackcloth and truss up our hair in dishclouts, Venerians will nevertheless pursue their pastime. If we hide our breasts, it must be with leather, for no cloth can keep their long nails out of our bosoms. Our eyes cause them to look lasciviously, and why? Because they are given to lechery." It's a sentiment that will strike a chord with anybody familiar with the line, "Look at what she was wearing, she was asking for it." In a 16th century take on slut-shaming, Jane also argued that men sought to absolve their own lust by blaming women with slanderous speeches against our sex. She even seeks to rehabilitate Eve, the original temptress herself, by proposing that Adam and all his male descendants couldn't survive without help from women. "God making woman of man's flesh, that she might be purer than he, doth evidently show how far we women are more excellent than men," Jane writes. "Our bodies are fruitful, whereby the world increaseth, and our care wonderful, by which man is preserved. From woman sprang man's salvation." The true identity of Jane Anger remains unknown. One academic theorized that her last name may have been an anglicization of the French surname Anjou. Some have ploughed through records to unearth a few real-life Jane or Joan Angers of the time, though none of the contenders quite matches up to the fiery author of Her Protection for Women. Others have even suggested that Jane may have been a pseudonym for a man. It is likely, however, that the mystery woman simply selected a pseudonym that truthfully encompassed the emotion she wished to express. She was anger by name and angry by nature. Marie Lejard de Gournay. When Renaissance writer Marie Lejard de Gournay, 1565 to 1645, read Michel de Montaigne's essays for the first time, the 18-year-old was so excited that her mother thought she should be sedated. Little did Marie know that she would meet the French philosopher himself some 5 years later, or that they would become so close that Montaigne grew to think of her as his fille d'alliance, loosely translated as adopted daughter, and that she would be made his literary executor and editor. Marie's widowed mother didn't believe in the education of girls, but that didn't stop her eldest daughter from teaching herself Latin or tearing through every book available to her in Gournay-sur-Aronde, the family estate. Montaigne's work single-handedly popularized the essay form, and Marie was thrilled by it. In her words, she began to desire knowledge, conversation, and fellowship with their author more than all things in the world. On the eve of her court debut in Paris in 1588, Marie heard that Montaigne was in town and sent a letter declaring her admiration for his essays to his hotel, sparking a mutual friendship and correspondence that would last for the 4 years until his death. On their long walks together on her estate, Montaigne and Marie would talk about books and the alterations he was planning to make to his essays. That Montaigne himself respected Marie as an intellectual equal and friend was remarkable and speaks to her intelligence and trustworthiness. This was, after all, the same man who mused on friendship that the ordinary capacity of women is inadequate for that communion and fellowship which is the nurse of this sacred bond. When Montaigne died, Marie grew close to his widow, Françoise de la Chassaigne, and his daughter, Léonore, spending 16 months at their chateau on the border of Bordeaux and the Périgord. She was entrusted with her former mentor's legacy and, up in the round tower of his library, she edited 8 new editions of essays, including translating its Greek and Latin references and incorporating his new notes and amendments. Not unlike her Père Montaigne, Marie was determined to forge her own path as a public intellectual. Nature has so honored me that, except for the more or less, I resemble my father, she wrote in the preface to the 1595 edition of Essays. I cannot take a step, whether in writing or speaking, that I do not find myself following in his footsteps. Unfortunately, it was not a good time to be a professional female author in France. The essayist Jean-Louis Gay de Balzac himself once said to a friend that if he were a police officer, he would drive back to domesticity all the women who wanted to write. Marie found allies in other learned European women. Dutch scholar Anna Maria van Schurman, who spoke 14 languages, praised Marie in a Latin poem as a great and noble-minded heroine and a strong defender of the cause of our sex. Marguerite de Valois, Queen of Navarre, bestowed on Marie a small financial stipend to take care of her needs and her library. Yet Marie was also greeted by snobbery and ridicule. After she penned a treatise in reaction to the assassination of King Henry VI, a satirical pamphlet entitled L'Anti-Gournay, against Gournay, appeared, prompting others to jump on the bandwagon. She was viciously caricatured in plays and criticized in print. Marie was even the subject of an intensely mean-spirited hoax. Three pranksters told her that King James I of England wanted to include her portrait and biography in a work on famous men and women. Marie later took them to court and, in a triumphant twist, included the text in an edition of her collected works, Les Advies, ou Les Présences de la Demoiselle de Gournay, the Demoiselle of Gournay's Presents and Offerings. Is there today a more specific target for slanderers than the condition of those who love learning if they do not belong to the church or the law? She asked in the 1641 preface to Les Advies. In our epoch, nothing is more stupid or ridiculous, next to poverty, than being an enlightened and learned man, except, of course, being an enlightened and learned woman, or simply aspiring, like me, to become one. Marie didn't let the mockery and scorn hold her back. She lived to be 80 and produced treatises on French literature, education, philosophy, and women's rights. Education, she said, was what would ultimately liberate the ladies oppressed by the tyranny of men. Books, in fact, much like the one she edited.
Lucrezia Marinella.
The late 16th and 17th centuries were not kind to women in Italy. During the Counter-Reformation, as the church tightened its grip on power, women were increasingly seen as sinful temptresses and wretched creatures. Male philosophers and writers even began debating their rightful place in society, if they deserved one at all, and nobody embodied these poisonous attitudes better than Giuseppe Passi, who published I Doneschi Difetti, The Defects of Women, in 1599. The scholar heaped scorn on women's intelligence and warned of their feminine wiles. Women, he suggested, were better off kept under lock and key by their husbands. Passi would have been able to get away with it too, were it not for Lucrezia Marinella, 1571 to 1653, one of the most learned women in Italy. At a young age, the Venetian scholar had authored everything from religious poetry to philosophical commentary, including an epic poem named La Colomba Sacra, which followed the story of a Christian woman who would rather martyr herself than abandon her religion. Lucrezia didn't want to let the misogyny of her male peers slide, especially as part of Passi's argument was that women also made rotten poets. In 1600, Lucrezia published her blistering treatise in defense of her gender, The Nobility and Excellence of Women and the Defects and Vices of Men. The Vices of Men took up 35 chapters. Lucrezia had never written anything like it before, though a quick glance at her upbringing confirms that she was uniquely placed to write it. Her father, Giovanni Marinelli, was a distinguished natural philosopher and physician who had published texts about women's issues and health when Lucrezia was just a girl. He had encouraged her to read books by women and to speak up at the many intellectual meetings he organized at home for the great and good of Venice. Where most girls were shipped off to either a nunnery or the marital bed when they came of age, Lucrezia managed to put off marriage until her 50s, crediting her singlehood as the reason she was able to pursue her studies. In The Nobility and Excellence of Women, not only did Lucrezia tackle Passi's criticism of women head-on, she also squared up to ancient philosophers like Aristotle and contemporary writers like Torquato Tasso and Boccaccio, seeing these men as part of an unbroken chain of misogynist thought. In this treatise of mine, she wrote in her introduction, I want to show that the feminine sex is nobler and more excellent than that of men, and I want this truth to shine in everyone's mind. and I hope to show this by means of reasons and examples that every man, even the stubborn ones, will be obliged to confirm with his own mouth. Lucrezia didn't just mount a defense of her gender by pointing out the philosophical inconsistencies and fallacies in the false objections of slanderers. She wanted no less than to argue for the superiority of women themselves, and cited everything from Plato's The Republic to contemporary philosophy. She even devoted an entire chapter to women learned and knowledgeable in many arts, to rebuke any man who believed that women were incapable of learning. Women are much nobler in their activities than men. If they do not exercise, or if they do not partake in this, it is because they are forbidden by men, who are being motivated by their obstinate ignorance, being, as they are, cocksure that women are not good at learning, she wrote. I would like such individuals to make this experiment, to exercise a boy and a girl of the same age and of the same good nature and talent in letters and arms. They would see in a very short time that the girl would much more quickly learn than the boy, and better, that she would beat him by a great margin. The nobility and excellence of women proved so popular that it was reissued a year after its release. And indeed, its greatest success lay in the effect that it had on its intended target, Giuseppe Passi. He began furiously backpedaling on some of his views and even recanted his woman-hating past in a new tract, Dello Stato Maritale, on the marital state. The content of the first part of this treatise began by praising women for their beauty, learning, and virtue, and affirming that they were nothing less than equal to men. Amelia Lagna. In 1978, an English scholar made a daring announcement. He'd figured out the identity of William Shakespeare's dark lady, the raven-eyed beauty praised in his sonnets. Amelia Lagna, 1569 to 1645, an Englishwoman thought to be of Jewish-Italian descent, was the cruel mistress who had driven the bard himself to distraction. So far, so good, except that there was little direct proof that Amelia had ever crossed paths with Shakespeare, other than some circumstantial evidence courtesy of the records of Amelia's physician, Simon Forman. What the claims did achieve, however, was to single-handedly resurrect Amelia from obscurity, where she had dwelled for some three centuries prior. A new generation of historians pored over Amelia's history, searching for proof that she was the woman who had inspired Shakespeare. They were met by a writer who was far more than the object of a male author's affections, a ferociously intelligent and inquisitive literary voice who was one of the first women in Britain to publish a book of poetry and the first to seek to make a living off her pen. In 1569, Amelia was born in London into the Bassano family, who were musicians by trade. They had originally left Venice to work in the court of Henry VIII. She was only seven when her father died, but the young Amelia was fortunate enough to be taken in and educated by Susan Bertie, the Dowager Countess of Kent. Amelia was 18 when she embarked upon a torrid five-year affair with Elizabeth I's cousin, Henry Carey, who was the Queen's Lord Chamberlain and was 45 years Amelia's senior. Their relationship came to a crashing halt when Amelia fell pregnant in 1592, and a marriage was swiftly arranged to Alfonso Lagna, a court musician and occasional military man. Little is known about Amelia's life once she fell from Henry's favour, though she reappears in historical records as a tutor to the young Anne Clifford, the daughter of Margaret, Countess of Cumberland. Her illegitimate child with Henry survived, but Amelia suffered multiple miscarriages when trying to conceive children with Alfonso. In 1597, her medical woes sent her to Foreman, who dutifully took note of her complaints and ailments in his case records, and then attempted to seduce her while Alfonso was at sea. It didn't work. In 1611, Amelia did something truly remarkable. She published Salve Deus Rex Judaeorum, Hail God, King of Jews, a book of epic poetry that boldly rewrote the book of Genesis, mostly from the perspective of Pontius Pilate's wife. In the Bible, the unnamed woman is the subject of a single verse in the New Testament, pleading with her husband not to sentence Jesus to death. Amelia seizes this scant source material by the throat and makes it sing. In the book's titular poem, Pilate's wife retells the story of creation and mounts an ambitious defense of Eve, and by extension, all women. Then let us have our liberty again, and challenge to yourselves no sovereignty. You came not in the world without our pain. Make that a bar against your cruelty. Your fault being greater, why should you disdain our being your equals, free from tyranny? It is no exaggeration to say that nothing like this had ever been published before. Elizabeth I may have dabbled in poetry, but non-aristocratic women like Amelia simply did not pick up the quill, let alone produce a book that was bought and sold at bookshops. The first 9 poems in the book also make it clear that Amelia was serious about turning this into a career. Dedicated to high-ranking women like the Queen and the Countess of Dorset, the poems seek to praise and flatter their subjects to obtain their patronage, the sort of patronage that Henry Carey bestowed on Shakespeare's playing company, the Lord Chamberlain's Men, when he became their patron 2 years after his split with Amelia. Unfortunately, Amelia did not succeed in her quest for patronage. She was 42 when Salve Deus Rex Judaeorum came out, and she never published again. We know that she was widowed in 1613 and briefly attempted to run a London school for the education of noblemen and gentlemen's children of great worth in 1617. The historical record peters out after that. She was listed as living near her son in London's Clerkenwell before dying in 1645. We may never find out any more about Amelia Lanya, or whether she was, indeed, the dark lady of Shakespeare's sonnets. But we know enough to call her England's first feminist poet. Mary Ann McCracken. Mary Ann McCracken, 1770 to 1866, was only 28 when she accompanied her brother on his lonely walk to the gallows, taking his arm as he made his way to the noose. "I did not weep until then," she later said. At 5 p.m., Henry Joy McCracken was hanged on the land that their great-great-grandfather had gifted to Belfast, the city that Mary and her family had done so much to help improve. In the backdrop were 4 decaying human heads mounted on spikes, the remains of other men who, like Henry, had been convicted as Republican rebels. In the face of this catastrophic loss, you might have expected Mary to withdraw from her Presbyterian family's many philanthropic causes. The McCrackens were well respected in Belfast. Her uncle had co-founded the Belfast Charitable Society, which was responsible for building the poorhouse, a shelter for the destitute, and the city's first hospital. While Henry's politics as a militant revolutionary for the Society of United Irishmen were not shared by the wider McCracken clan, both Mary and Henry were part of a long family tradition that sought to improve the lot of their fellow Irish. But the death of her brother did not dampen Mary's enthusiasm as a social reformer. She would live to be 96, having straddled the 18th and 19th centuries, witnessing the profound upheavals that industrialization and the rise of republicanism brought to Ireland. By the time she was laid to rest in 1866, Mary had championed a dizzying variety of causes, including the welfare of children, reform of the prison system, and a halt to the dangerous practice of employing young boys as chimney sweeps. She had also raised funds for those too sick and poor to pay for healthcare, assisted victims of the Great Famine, and, during her 19-year tenure as Secretary of the Ladies' Committee for the Poorhouse, improved the schooling of and welfare provision for the impoverished women who passed through its doors. Mary's dedication to what was good and right extended to her personal life too. Henry had a young illegitimate daughter who had been left to fend for herself after his execution. Against the wishes of her family, Mary took the child into her own home and raised her herself. But it was the rights of women and the abolition of slavery about which Mary felt most strongly. She and her sister Margaret had guaranteed themselves an unusual measure of financial independence by setting up a business that manufactured and sold embroidered muslin cloth. Mary dreamed of a future where women and men would experience true emancipation and be united in pursuit of the common good. She felt keenly the parallels between the horrors of slavery, the political oppression of the Irish under British rule, and the domestic servitude of women, and saw her brother's republican cause as presenting the greatest hope of change. Is it not almost time for the clouds of error and prejudice to disperse, and that the female part of the creation, as well as the male, should throw off the fetters with which they have been so long mentally bound? She wrote to Henry before his death. I think the reign of prejudice is nearly at an end, and that the truth and justice of our cause alone is sufficient to support it, as there can be no argument produced in favour of the slavery of women that has not been used in favour of general slavery. When Mary shut down her muslin business in 1815, she channeled her energies into becoming one of Belfast's most prominent activists. Her grandniece, Anna McCleary, noted that Mary's strength of personality came out best when confronted with evidence of injustice. She had naturally a quick and hasty temper, though evidence of this was rarely seen. But even when at an advanced age, if a helpless person were wronged or an animal cruelly treated, it was startling to see how her eye would flash and to hear her indignant words. Well into her old age, Mary never gave up on her beliefs. Even after Britain abolished slavery in 1833, she railed against its persistence overseas. When she was just 17 days shy of turning 89, she was distributing anti-slavery flyers to people setting out for the US, which she described as the land of the tyrant and the slave. She even abstained from eating sugar to protest against its reliance on the slave trade. When she died, just before her 100th birthday, Belfast lost one of its greatest champions for the poor and marginalised. And as one tribute put it, a life so rich in all good works and a spirit so full of love. Sojourner Truth. In 1851, a middle-aged woman, 1.8 metres, almost 6 feet tall, with a deep-speaking voice and an unerring eye for a catchy phrase, got to her feet during the Women's Rights Convention in Akron, Ohio. I could work as much and eat as much as a man, when I could get it, and bear the lash as well. Sojourner Truth, circa 1797 to 1883, declared to the audience. And ain't I a woman? I have borne 13 children, and seen most all sold off to slavery, and when I cried out with my mother's grief, none but Jesus heard me. And ain't I a woman? The Ain't I a Woman speech, which Sojourner delivered impromptu, went down in history as one of the most famous feminist and abolitionist speeches ever made. But there is much more to Sojourner's life than her most famous public address. Over the course of 8 decades, this illiterate, runaway slave-turned reformer electrified audiences all across North America, penned her own memoirs, and crusaded for social justice on issues like universal suffrage, the abolition of slavery, and women's rights. Sojourner was born into slavery as Isabella Belle Balmfree, the granddaughter of an African man and woman who had survived the brutal Middle Passage, in which slaves were shipped under terrible conditions from Africa to America, where they were sold to a rich Dutch family in a rural New York hamlet. When her parents' owner died, she was separated from her family and sold to a vicious English yeoman who had little reservation about stripping 9-year-old Belle and beating her until blood poured from her wounds. She was eventually sold 2 more times, finally ending up in the household of a landowner called John Dumont. As Sojourner came of age in the Dumont household, New York was slowly changing in its attitude to slavery. In 1817, lawmakers in New York State promised that all slaves who were born before 1799 would be freed in a decade's time. But Sojourner's desire for freedom was growing faster than time allowed. She already had seen her mother die of palsy and her elderly father freeze to death after he was abandoned by his owners. Dumont promised to free her a year ahead of the emancipation deadline if she worked hard in the fields. And she began to labor with such intensity and determination that she accidentally chopped off a finger. Then Dumont changed his mind, claiming that the injury meant she had lost working time, and so he could not free her ahead of schedule. All her life, Sojourner had nurtured a deep sense of prophet-like connection to God, attributing her speaking talent to the divine and asserting that God's voice instructed her in all she did. Now, divine guidance told Sojourner that she couldn't wait. Late in 1826, with a knapsack on her back and her daughter Sophia in her arms, she fled. A pro-emancipation Dutch family, the Van Wagenens, took in her and her child. They ended up negotiating with a furious Dumont to buy both Sojourner and Sophia for $25. In exchange, Sojourner would work off the money owed as a free woman. Her first act of freedom was to track down her son, Peter, who had been kidnapped and sold by the Dumonts as a child. After a protracted year-long court battle, Peter was finally delivered into the arms of his mother. It was, Sojourner maintained, down to a higher power. God only could have made such people hear me. Life as a free woman was not always easy. Peter began dabbling in petty crime and eventually died as a seaman on a whaling ship, breaking his mother's heart in the process. Bereft of the son who she had fought so hard to retrieve, she turned to God once again. "Lord, whither shall I go?" she asked. A voice spoke to her, plain as day. "Go east." She obeyed, now reborn as Sojourner Truth. The Holy Spirit, she maintained, had ordered her to cast off her slave name. She ended up in Massachusetts, at the Northampton Association of Education and Industry, a progressive Massachusetts commune that was founded on principles of spirituality, activism, and equality, and where labor was split fairly between men and women. It was here that Sojourner began to develop her gift for preaching. After the community disbanded in 1846, she would spend the rest of her life speaking to audiences about the evils of gender inequality and slavery. The crowds were not always welcoming, but Sojourner was more than equipped to defend herself. At one talk, a heckler voiced the persistent rumour that this powerful orator was a man in disguise. In response, Sojourner bared her breasts and told them that she had suckled many a white babe to the exclusion of her own offspring, that it was not to her shame that she uncovered her breast before them, but to their shame. Her ability to silence, shame, and charm a crowd earned her many admirers. A New York independent journalist wrote, "I have never in my life seen anything like the magical influence that subdued the mobbish spirit of the day and turned the jibes and sneers of an excited crowd into notes of respect and admiration." Through Sojourner, thousands of Americans were made aware of the evils of slavery and iniquity. In 1864, she even met Abraham Lincoln and campaigned for freed slaves to receive land grants from the government. But the true testament to Sojourner's abilities in persuading the nation perhaps lies in her final encounter with her former slave master. In 1849, she paid the aging Dumont a visit and found that he had renounced slavery. As she recounts in her memoirs, the man who had once owned her and her children, the man who had forced her to work so hard that she lost a finger, said he could then see that slavery was the wickedest thing in the world, the greatest curse the earth had ever felt. Ida B. Wells. 71 years before Rosa Parks refused to budge from her seat, Ida B. Wells, 1862 to 1931, was standing her ground on a train from Memphis to Nashville in Tennessee. The 22-year-old remained in her seat when the conductor ordered her to move to the train carriage reserved for black people. She had bought a first-class ticket for the ladies' carriage, and she intended to sit there for the whole journey. When the conductor tried to yank Ida from her seat, she bit his hand. In the end, three men dragged her out of her seat, so she sued the railway company and argued her case all the way to the Tennessee Supreme Court. This would be considered bold in Rosa Parks's day, but it was even more remarkable in 1884. Ida had been born into slavery and was only 5 months old when the Emancipation Proclamation freed her parents from their slave owner in Holly Springs, Mississippi. She was part of the first generation of African Americans to come of age as free men and women, and she would spend her entire life agitating for their long-awaited rights to be respected, embraced, and fully realized. At the time of the train incident, Ida was a teacher in Memphis, one of the more progressive cities in the South. Her outrage at her treatment on the train found an outlet when the editor of a weekly newspaper aimed at black audiences invited her to write about her experience. Under the pseudonym Iola, Ida's sharply observed and incisive article instantly found an audience. But, although she won against the railway company, 3 years later, the Tennessee Supreme Court decided to overturn her case. "I felt so disappointed because I had hoped such great things from my suit for my people," she wrote in her diary. "Oh God, is there no redress, no peace, no justice in this land for us?" Shaken but still undaunted, Ida continued writing, eventually editing and co-owning the Memphis Free Speech and Headlight, which she renamed the Free Speech. It quickly became one of the most radical and progressive voices for the black community in the city. In 1892, three black business owners, Calvin McDowell, Tom Moss, and Will Stewart, were brutally lynched by a white mob. Appalled by the killings, Ida took to the editorial pages to denounce the violence and warn the black community that they were no longer safe in Memphis. "There is therefore only one thing left to do," she wrote passionately. "Save our money and leave a town which will neither protect our lives and property nor give us a fair trial in the courts, but takes us out and murders us in cold blood when accused by white persons." The free speech offices were ransacked and destroyed in retaliation. Ida was fortunate to have been out of town on business when it happened, but she received messages warning her in no uncertain terms that she would be beaten, dumped in the river, or hanged. Ida settled in Chicago, where she continued investigating and exposing lynchings in the South. Today, it is believed that up to 3,957 black people were murdered in southern states between 1877 and 1950. She embarked on speaking tours up and down the country to raise awareness of the cruel treatment of African Americans, and even travelled to the UK to drum up support for her cause. Ida firmly believed that the same barbarism and inequality that allowed slavery to thrive in the United States fueled the epidemic of lynchings. "The lawlessness which has been here described is like unto that which prevailed under slavery," she told an audience in Boston. "The very same forces are at work now as then." Her activism extended far beyond journalism. Ever alive to the intersections of class, gender, and ethnicity, she campaigned for women's suffrage and founded the Negro Fellowship League in Chicago to assist migrants from the South and provide shelter for homeless black people. She was also a founding member of the National Association for the Advancement of Colored People, NAACP, which is now the biggest grassroots civil rights organization in the US. Ida, however, never willing to compromise or back down, ended up leaving the group, as it was not militant enough for her. Her passion even drove her to run for the Illinois State Senate, though she did not gain enough votes to get elected. Ida died in 1931 at the age of 68, a passionate advocate for civil rights well into her old age. She did not live to see the passage of the Civil Rights Act of 1968, the landmark piece of legislation that ended segregation and outlawed employment discrimination based on race, color, religion, or gender. But if Ida had ever felt exhausted from her lifelong fight for equality, she'd never let it show, even when she faced down threats to her life after the ransacking of the free speech offices. She dug her heels in, just as she had that fateful day on the train. "I felt that one had better die fighting against injustice," she observed, "than to die like a dog or a rat in a trap." Higuchi Ichio. Higuchi Ichio, 1872-1896, always wanted to be a writer, and a famous one at that. "Since I was about 9 years old, I had loathed to live and die in obscurity," she wrote in her diary. "Day in, day out, I wished to surpass others even by an inch." And her wish was granted. In 2004, the Bank of Japan introduced a new design for the 5,000 yen note. On one side is a spray of fragrant irises. On the other is Higuchi, the Meiji-era author, widely acclaimed in her day. When Higuchi was born in 1872, Tokyo was still known as Edo, and fearsome samurai ruled the land. But as the Meiji period, 1868 to 1912, wore on, Japan was soon turned upside down with the reinstallation of the emperor and the dismantling of the traditional feudal class system. Higuchi's father, who had worked tirelessly in order to attain the rank of samurai just a few years prior, was forced to take on a low-ranking government post. The only thing that wasn't changing fast was Japan's treatment of women. They were still treated as the property of their fathers, and then their husbands, and education was low on their list of patriarchal priorities. Higuchi's formal education came to an end just after she topped her elementary school at the age of 12, because, as her mother put it, too much education spoils a young girl's future. She should learn sewing and help with the housework. Her father was unusually enlightened for his time and arranged for her to enter a private girls' school when she turned 14, where she was tutored in traditional Japanese poetry, waka, and literature. It was the kind of place where girls turned up for class in lacquered horse-drawn carriages. In her comparatively drab attire, Higuchi began honing her critical powers of observation, noting of her well-to-do classmates, "I found my old clothes more precious than their damask and brocade, for I found in mine the unfathomable benevolence of my parents, and was thoroughly pleased with them." Disaster befell her family in 1898, when Higuchi was only 17. Her father was struck down by tuberculosis and died shortly after, squandering their savings on a failed business venture. Her aging mother and little sister were forced to take on odd jobs as seamstresses and washerwomen. As the sister with the highest level of education, Higuchi suddenly found herself thrust into the position of caretaker and primary breadwinner. It was now imperative that she find a way to make money from her writing, and she set about it with the seriousness of a newly minted head of household, enlisting the help of a novelist and journalist named Nakarai Tosui. Higuchi sweated over her manuscripts at home, only to rip them up in fits of pique, but something in her refused to throw in the towel. Perverse as I am, I can't give it up quite so easily, and presumptuously enough, I have started writing again, she wrote after one aborted attempt. I must, by all means, complete it by day after tomorrow. I feel that I will die if I don't finish it. If people wish to laugh at my faint heart, let them laugh. Success finally came with her novella, Takekurabe, Child's Play, which became a hit when it was published in full in the literary periodical Bungei Kurabu, the literature club. But Higuchi found it difficult to accept praise. 9 out of 10 of the people who come to see me are delighted just to see a woman. They are drawn by the unusual, she said. That's why even the merest scrap I produce sets them all aflutter. Higuchi's reticence could also have something to do with the fact that she had sacrificed so much to get to that point. She had developed feelings for Tosui, but was advised to cut off ties to her mentor or risk besmirching her family's reputation. She had sold almost all her possessions to keep her family afloat. They poured the money into a small convenience store in the red light district of Yoshiwara, only to watch it fail when a competitor opened on the opposite side of the road. The street kids who visited Higuchi's shop did, however, provide her with the characters for Takekurabe, which follows a group of childhood friends from Yoshiwara as their paths diverge and pull them toward their tragic destinies. Higuchi records their fates with a careful and deeply sympathetic eye, as she does in all her work. She wrote around 20 novellas and short stories, many inspired by the social reality of the red light district she called home, and often following marginalized women, prostitutes, barmaids, mistresses, attempting to carve out some independence of their own. It was the first time their stories had been told, providing a unique insight into the lives of these people who had been written out of official history. Higuchi had worked as an author for only 5 years when she fell sick with tuberculosis, the same illness that killed her father, and she died at the age of 24. She would no doubt be glad to know that her work lives on in Japan's bookshelves and banknotes. As she once wrote, "I do not desire a brocade gown, nor am I after a stately mansion. How could I ever stain my name, which I wish to leave behind, for 1,000 years for the sake of temporary gain? I will rewrite even a short story 3 times, and then I will ask the world to pass judgment." Alice Dunbar Nelson. Alice Dunbar Nelson's obituary would have infuriated her. Born in 1875, when she died in 1935, a Philadelphia newspaper ran her obituary with the headline, "Alice Ruth Moore's Two Husbands. First, a volatile genius. Second, a calm newsman," before going on to note a contemporary's recollection of the wife of a poet borrowing an ice cream freezer. After all, she had only stayed with her first husband, the celebrated poet Paul Laurence Dunbar, for 4 years, and had married calm newsman Robert J. Nelson when she was 41. Still, it wouldn't have surprised her. There was a reason she held on to Dunbar's last name, even after their separation and his death. As a multiracial woman who proudly identified as Black, the author, activist, and essayist was used to battling the prevailing sexism and racism of her century. She wasn't going to say no if using her famous ex-husband's last name gave her an advantage. Born in New Orleans, Alice was the daughter of a former slave turned seamstress and a sailor. Her mixed-race heritage and auburn hair meant that people sometimes mistook her for a white woman, leading her to a complicated relationship with her own complexion. "White enough to pass for white," she once wrote, "but with a darker family background, a real love for the mother race, and no desire to be numbered among the white race." She was tormented by bullies and taunted with cries of "half-white nigger" on the playground, even from a Black girl she considered her friend. When Alice published her first book of short stories and poetry at 20, her racial ambiguity helped her to enter places that were ordinarily barred to other people of African-American heritage. There were moments of humor, too. She was twice kicked off a segregated train carriage for Black travelers because the conductor insisted that I was a white woman. Alice returned to the theme of identity many times over the course of her literary career, though she sometimes cloaked it in metaphor to make it more palatable for publishers. In one short story, she writes of her protagonist, Sister Josepha. In a flash, she realized the deception of the life she would lead, and the cruel self-torture of wonder at her own identity. Already, as if in anticipation of the world's questionings, she was asking herself, "Who am I? What am I?" It was her first book, Violets and Other Tales, that caught Paul Laurence Dunbar's eye. After a courtship sweetly conducted over letters, they married in 1898 and settled in New York, where they plunged into the explosive cultural movement that became known as the Harlem Renaissance. Paul, however, drank heavily and was a serial cheater, and their marriage soon crumbled. But though her second marriage to Robert J. Nelson lasted until her death, she could never be accused of being a prude. She had a passionate, short-lived affair with a man who was 12 years younger, and she had multiple relationships with women, penning a sonnet to one declaring of their liaison, "I had not thought to ope that secret room." Alice was never able to make a full-time career out of her writing. She was constantly juggling her time as an author, speaker and campaigner for black women's suffrage and the anti-lynching cause with her full-time gig as a teacher. "Lots of irons in the fire," she wrote in her diary of her many commitments. "But where is the deliverance from my house of bondage?" Even when travelling the country to give lectures on poetry and the African-American experience, she found herself haunted by the spectre of her late husband. "My talk on the Negro's literary reaction to American life apparently appreciated, but of course they would want to hear dialect Dunbar at the end," she wrote of one event in Pennsylvania. Alice lived to see only 2 volumes of her work published in her lifetime. She was plagued by self-doubt and wrote of her insecurities and dissatisfaction in her diary. "Life is such a god-awful mess, and I am such a total and complete failure. God!" A few months later, she noted, "Life is one continual procession of visitors, one unending routine of collecting and washing glasses and emptying ashtrays." In fact, it is likely that Alice herself would have turned into a footnote to her first husband's life if biographer Gloria T. Hull had not chanced upon a collection of her writing archived by her niece. The discovery single-handedly revived Alice's reputation as a writer. Hull notes that Alice's own unique life and voice were always there, waiting to be discovered. "I think of her existence from its beginnings," she writes, "to the eventual scattering of her ashes over the Delaware River, and know that she was a magnificent woman." Zitkala Shah. "Even nature seemed to have no place for me. I was neither a wee girl nor a tall one, neither a wild Indian nor a tame one," the Native American activist and author Zitkala Shah, 1876 to 1938, wrote in 1921, describing her childhood in South Dakota's Yankton Reservation. She would battle this sense of alienation for all of her life and, in the process, would blaze a trail as one of her community's greatest voices for representation and change. Born Gertrude Simmons to a Sioux mother and a white man, Zitkala Shah, Redbird in the Lakota language, began life in one of the most tumultuous years for conflict between Native American tribes and the U.S. government. 3 years earlier, gold had been discovered in the Black Hills within the Great Sioux Reservation. Thousands of miners flooded into the region in contravention of a U.S. Sioux treaty that guaranteed Native American ownership in perpetuity. War broke out when the U.S. government mounted an aggressive military campaign to seize the land, claiming victory in 1877 after the surrender of a large majority of Sioux. Thanks to new laws passed in Congress, Sioux territory dwindled from 134 million acres to 15 million, and it was decreed that Native American children like Zitkala Shah were to be extracted from their homes and educated in boarding schools to better assimilate into pale-faced society. Zitkala Shah was about 8 when she was shipped east on the Iron Horse Railway to a Quaker school in Wabash, Indiana. She subsequently enrolled at Earlham College in Richmond, Indiana, against her mother's wishes, and discovered a knack for public speaking, going up against her white peers and winning oratory contests. She also studied piano and violin, playing violin for 2 years with the New England Conservatory of Music in Boston, Massachusetts. But her assimilationist schooling was both a blessing and a curse. She would never fully belong in white society, and every educational achievement took her farther from the pastoral upbringing of her childhood. In 1898, Zitkala Shah took on a teaching post at Carlisle Indian Industrial School in Pennsylvania. The school adopted an especially brutal interpretation of the word assimilation. Students were beaten, deprived of food, and even forced to labour for white families living nearby. Discarding her English name in favour of a Lakota one, she began to publish autobiographical essays and short stories in Atlantic Monthly and Harper's Bazaar. Writing that documented and celebrated Native American life and illuminated the cruel and distressing truth behind the education system. Knowing that her traditions were under attack, she also attempted to preserve cultural knowledge as best she could, through books such as American Indian Stories and an opera that recreated the Sioux Sundance, a ritual that had been banned by the US authorities. Zitkala Shah's causes were controversial at times, even among her own people. She campaigned against the use of the increasingly popular peyote, embarking on speaking tours across the Midwest in support of a ban on the debilitating and degenerating ceremonial drug. She formed uncomfortable alliances with white conservatives who supported the anti-Native American policies that she passionately hated. But Zitkala Shah also became Secretary Treasurer of the Society of American Indians, SAI, the first Native American-run advocacy organization, and became the editor of its accompanying publication, American Indian Magazine. She blossomed into a passionate spokesperson and political campaigner for Native American rights, but expressed frustration at the glacial pace of change. Everyone Indian who has attempted to do real uplift work for the tribes gets stung, she wrote in a letter to a friend. No wonder that he quits trying, goes back to the blanket, and sits in the teepee like a boiled owl. I have not sense enough to stop. Wouldn't know until I was killed, and the chances are I wouldn't know then, being dead. The SAI was disbanded in 1919 after falling apart under the strain of internal dispute. Undeterred, Zitkala Shah founded the National Council of American Indians 7 years later and was elected president. Under her leadership, the group became a powerful advocate for Native American people. Guided by the official motto, "Help Indians help themselves in protecting their rights and properties," the organization grew to represent no fewer than 49 tribes. It fought countless battles with the US government for better legal and civic rights, spanning everything from improved ration distribution for reservations to land settlement agreements and benefits for Native American war veterans. One of her greatest achievements was an investigation into how oil corporations were defrauding and even murdering Native Americans in Oklahoma in order to seize their land. The resulting book, Oklahoma's Poor Rich Indians, An Orgy of Graft and Exploitation of the Five Civilized Tribes, Legalized Robbery, which she co-authored, prompted a government inquiry and led to the creation of what was called the Indian New Deal, a landmark piece of legislation that restored Native American land rights. Having fought all her life for the rights of her people, this tireless advocate died at the age of 61. She is buried next to her husband in Arlington National Cemetery, Virginia. Edith Margaret Garrod. In 1908, the suffragettes had a problem. The campaign for votes was going well. 300,000 people had shown up to a mass rally in London's Hyde Park in June, but they faced increasing aggression from the public and the police. Members of Emmeline Pankhurst's group, the Women's Social and Political Union, WSPU, were routinely arrested. Pankhurst's own daughter, Christabel, was imprisoned in 1905, and some civilians were also growing hostile to their cause. At a rally in Reading, Berkshire, one man even leaped on stage and knocked out a suffragette. Enter Edith Margaret Garrod, 1872 to 1971. This diminutive woman from the Welsh Valleys, believed to be one of the first female martial arts teachers in the West, stood at 1.5 metres, 4 feet 11 inches, but had no difficulty tossing an 83-kilogram, 13-stone police officer over her shoulder. And it was Edith who taught the same skills to the suffragettes, even training a league of female guards to protect Emmeline Pankhurst. Woman is exposed to many perils nowadays because so many who call themselves men are not worthy of that exalted title, and it is her duty to learn how to defend herself, she noted in Health and Strength magazine. A woman who knows jiu-jitsu, even though she may not be physically strong, is not helpless. Edith and her husband William had been introduced to jiu-jitsu at a demonstration at the Alhambra Theatre in London several years earlier. As fitness enthusiasts and physical education teachers, the pair had been so impressed by the sport that they immediately signed up as students. They sped through the course and eventually ended up running a dojo, martial arts hall, in London's Golden Square, where Edith taught special classes for women and children. The suffragette cause didn't just draw Edith's attention. She also believed that it was wrong that these women were being attacked for their beliefs. On two nights every week, she offered self-defense classes to suffragettes, drilling them in the fine art of excruciating wrist locks and shoulder throws. The press caught wind of the training sessions and invented a nickname for her students, Jujutsu Suffragettes. Soon, the classes became so popular that Edith had to rent a new room and set up her own dojo in London's Soho district. It even provided a safe haven for any window-smashing protesters fleeing police. They would run to Edith's studio during a demonstration and conceal any incriminating evidence under the mats and floorboards. Physical force seems the only thing in which women have not demonstrated their equality to men, she mused in an essay for the suffragette publication Votes for Women. And whilst we are waiting for the evolution which is slowly taking place and bringing about that equality, we might just as well take time by the forelock and use science, otherwise jiu-jitsu. A few months later, Edith was holding public jiu-jitsu shows with some 30 suffragettes to resounding applause, repeated curtain calls, and more than a few requests for autographs. In just a few seconds, she would disable men twice her size. She even felled a Daily Mirror journalist who requested a demonstration. He later wrote that he crawled painfully away, pitying the constable whose ill fortune it should be to lay hands on Mrs. Garrod. Then came Black Friday in 1910. A 300-strong group of suffragettes marched on Parliament to demand an audience with the Prime Minister. They were met with brutal violence from truncheon-wielding police officers. Women were shoved to the ground and trampled underfoot, or picked up and hurled into groups of male onlookers where they were groped and fondled. No fewer than 115 protesters were arrested, and two later died of their injuries. It became obvious that simply teaching small groups of women self-defense was not going to be enough. By 1913, the British government enacted a law, commonly referred to as the Cat and Mouse Act, to trap hunger-striking suffragettes in a vicious cycle of arrest. Once a hunger striker released from prison on grounds of ill health had recovered, the police would re-arrest her, effectively keeping her in indefinite detention. It was imperative that the leaders of the movement remain on the streets to rally support for the cause, so the WSPU created the Bodyguard, an underground cell of women tasked with protecting the leaders of the movement from this police harassment. Edith, of course, was asked to be their jiu-jitsu teacher. She trained them in secret, teaching them to hide wooden clubs under their dresses and use them against any possible assailants, and instructing them in the fine art of trickery. At one rally, officers triumphantly carted off a veiled Emmeline Pankhurst after a skirmish with the bodyguard, only to realise, on unveiling her, that the women had tricked them with a decoy. The bodyguard protected Emmeline until it was dissolved on the advent of World War I. In 1918, the Representation of the People Act was passed, and some women were given the right to vote. But it would be another 10 years before universal suffrage was introduced. Yet Edith never forgot her training. She continued to teach classes into her 50s and even demonstrated a wrist lock on a journalist who had come to interview her on her 94th birthday. "It is the mind which really has control," she told him, "not only of your muscles and your limbs and how you use them, but also of your thoughts, your whole attitude to life and other people." May Ziyade. In 1935, May Ziyade, 1886 to 1941, was languishing in a psychiatric institution in Beirut, Lebanon, where she would remain for 4 years. The Lebanese-Palestinian author and translator had sunk into depression with the shock of twin losses. The death of her parents and the death of her great love, the Arab-American poet Khalil Gibran. Instead of offering sympathy, her relatives sought to seize her estate by committing her to an asylum. It was a dramatic change from her previous life as a leading Arab intellectual and essayist. As a girl, May had inherited a love of writing from her Lebanese father, Elias Ziadeh, the founding editor of the Egyptian newspaper Al-Maroussa. She adored the romantic poets and wrote fondly of Byron, whom she described as a poet of violence and sweetness. Did Byron ever dream, she wondered, that a Lebanese girl would spend with him or with some of his works long, lonely hours in the woods of Lebanon? At the age of 25, she published a collection of poetry in French entitled Fleurs de Rêve and followed her father into journalism. Her education at a French convent boarding school in Lebanon, followed by a degree in modern languages, served her well. In her body of work from this time, leading essays and articles on gender equality and political governance sit next to short stories, novels and plays, which in turn were complemented by her Arabic translations of European authors like Arthur Conan Doyle. May issued passionate calls to advance the status of women in poetry and prose, and spoke publicly on the issue. "The duties required of women are numerous indeed," she wrote in an essay titled Women and Work. "She has to be good-looking, dainty, smooth-tempered. She has to bear children, take care of their physical, moral, and intellectual growth. She has to know the principles of economy and of successful housekeeping. Thus, she has to perform the functions of a minister of the interior, a minister of foreign affairs, of education, of communications, of colonies, etc. All those responsibilities which are distributed among a select group of men are shouldered by a single woman, and yet we keep saying that she is weak." Around 1913, May founded a salon at her Cairo family home that blossomed into a nexus of Arab literary culture, attracting numerous distinguished artists and writers of the time. Unlike other salons, men and women of all backgrounds and religions mixed freely. May's salon was democratic, in the sense that it was open to various classes of intellectuals and to literary men and women of different nationalities: Egyptians, Lebanese, Syrians, Europeans, and others. One visitor, the scholar Taha Hussein, remembered. They discussed all sorts of topics, local and international. Unique in character, This salon had a decided influence on its habitués, who spoke highly of it in their memoirs and their reminiscences. Unfortunately, May's reputation as the greatly admired and charming hostess of the salon began to surpass her literary accomplishments. The Egyptian author Abbas Mahmoud al-Akkad wrote approvingly of her salon and rather more patronizingly of her appearance. She turns the whole world into a reception hall where beauty is not disturbed by anything, or maybe it is her looks that resemble a beautiful museum packed with good taste. Her mysterious relationship with Khalil Gibran, too, began to overshadow her own literary talent. Khalil lived in New York and May in Beirut. They never once met in person, though they carried on a passionate correspondence for 20 years. We have no record of May's letters, only of Khalil's. In one message he writes, "Do you know how much I desire to receive that letter after having read a brief snatch of it? A divine fragment which arrived to announce the dawning of a new day?" May was single-handedly responsible for introducing Khalil's work to the Arab world, and in turn fell in love with and adopted Shir Mantur, the Arabic style of prose poetry that he popularized. She never married, and rumors about her personal life, that she was in love with Khalil, that she was a lesbian, began to spread about her. Only a few friends stood by her when Khalil's death and the passing of her parents catalyzed her depression and sent her to the asylum. It was 4 years before a long-running press campaign to free her finally paid off, and she was released. May continued to write in her final years, but her reputation had been irretrievably damaged. The great woman responsible for molding Arab literature had long passed into the realm of the forgotten. Before she died, May simply said, "I hope that after my death, someone will do me justice." Bertha Lutz. When the UN Charter was signed by members of the fledgling United Nations in 1945, there were only 4 female delegates, out of a total of 850 there to sign it. Bertha Lutz, 1894 to 1976, a Brazilian zoologist, was one of them, and she believed that the foundational treaty of the UN was lacking something: women. In fact, the word women wasn't mentioned once in the draft of the UN founding treaty. This meant that half of the world had been effectively omitted from its greatest peacekeeping and human rights organization. With the support of a group of female representatives from Latin America and Australia, Lutz fought successfully for the inclusion of women so that the Charter affirmed the dignity and worth of the human person in the equal rights of men and women. Her efforts weren't exactly appreciated by her colleagues in the West. US delegate Virginia Gildersleeve confronted Lutz and told her not to ask for anything for women in the Charter, since that would be a very vulgar thing to do. British representative Ellen Wilkinson told Lutz that gender equality already existed because she had just been appointed to the King's Privy Council. "I'm afraid not," Lutz recalls informing her. "It only means that you have arrived." Lutz was born in 1894 to an English nurse and a Swiss-Brazilian naturalist and physician in Sao Paulo. Her father specialized in tropical medicine, and Lutz often followed him on rainforest expeditions to collect specimens of her favorite animal, tree frogs, or as she called them, "my brothers the frogs." While studying for a degree in biology at the Sorbonne in Paris, Lutz developed an interest in the growing women's suffrage movement in the UK. She didn't agree with the violence used by British suffragettes, but she felt a keen affinity with their goals. When Lutz returned home in 1918, she was incensed by a newspaper columnist's declaration that the recent feminist achievements in the UK and the US would have no effect on Brazil. She issued a passionate call for a political league of Brazilian women who believed that women should contribute to society in all areas of life, including politics and business. Brazilian society thought that women were best confined to the domestic sphere, though Lutz found sly ways of arguing around this. Women's domain, all feminists agree, is the home, she said of female participation in politics. But nowadays, the home no longer is just the space encompassed within four walls. In 1922, she followed her own advice and founded the Federação Brasileira pelo Progresso Feminino, FBPF, or Brazilian Federation for the Advancement of Women. Its initial success was modest and reflected the concerns of its educated upper-middle-class membership. For example, it successfully lobbied the government to allow girls to attend its most prestigious academy, Colégio Pedro II, an elite breeding ground for future politicians and movers and shakers. Lutz didn't neglect her love of herpetology, the study of amphibians and reptiles. In fact, she sometimes found novel ways to combine the two interests. When she travelled to Baltimore, Maryland, in 1922 to attend the first Pan-American Conference of Women, a groundbreaking political summit that gathered together women from 32 countries, she astonished a delegate by sinking to her knees near a stream and pulling a frog from the water. Examining her prize catch, she explained that it was the first time she had ever seen such a specimen, and spent the rest of the day collecting more for her lab. Even as she fought tirelessly for women's rights, she continued to research and publish scientific studies on her favorite amphibians, and even discovered a new species of frog, which now bears the name Lutz's Rapids Frog. Lutz knew the importance of guaranteeing the legal rights of women. She studied for a law degree in Rio de Janeiro, and in 1932, she led an FBPF delegation to meet with Brazilian President Getúlio Vargas to argue for women's suffrage as his government prepared to rewrite the country's electoral code. When women finally went to the polls in 1933, Brazil officially became the sixth country in the world to grant women the vote. Lutz was appointed to the commission in charge of rewriting the country's constitution, and she made sure that it incorporated women's rights, including the right to earn equal pay and hold public office. She even ran for government herself, but failed to win a seat. Even after Vargas seized power in 1937 and shut down Congress, Lutz continued to represent Brazil at international conferences, including that fateful United Nations conference in 1945. She remained proud that it was the women of her region who were pushing for equality. The mantle is falling off the shoulders of the Anglo-Saxons, she wrote in her memoirs. We, Latin American women, shall have to do the next stage of battle for women. Margaret Sanger. Margaret Sanger, 1879 to 1966, was born towards the end of the 19th century in Corning, New York, when condoms weren't just seen as obscene and immoral, they were actually banned. Under the 1873 Comstock Act, it was illegal to send any device or item for the prevention of conception through the post. Contraception was a dirty word, and Sanger witnessed the effects of that prudishness firsthand. She had 10 brothers and sisters and was born into a poor Irish Catholic family to a mother who struggled with her health. By the age of 50, Sanger's mother had died of tuberculosis. Her health had crumbled as a result of repeated pregnancy and childbirth. It was little wonder that Sanger once said, "Enforced motherhood is the most complete denial of a woman's right to life and liberty." Sanger was determined to leave her birthplace, and found her escape by qualifying as a nurse in 1902 and marrying an architect named William Sanger that same year. By 1910, Sanger and her family had moved to the bright lights of New York City and discovered their place among the radical intellectuals and bohemians of Greenwich Village. Change bristled in the air. A new political culture was flourishing around them, one that was concerned with social inequality and had a vision of a better world. Sanger, now a mother of three, signed up to the Liberal Club and joined the Socialist Party of New York, traveling to New Jersey and Massachusetts to take part in labor strikes. It was around this time that she also began working as a midwife and nurse in some of the most deprived neighborhoods in the city. On the Lower East Side, she saw women forced into destitution and despair by the same forces that had driven her mother to the grave. They had no choice over their reproductive health. Like a lightning strike, pregnancy was something that simply happened to them, whether they wanted it to or not. One day, a doctor that Sanger worked with advised a patient that she should force her husband to sleep on the roof if she didn't want another child. "You can't have your cake and eat it too," he laughed. In Sanger's autobiography, she wrote that the desperate woman pleaded with her after the doctor left the room. "Tell me the secret, and I'll never breathe it to a soul." Sanger had no answer to give. Several weeks later, the woman was dead. She had contracted a fatal infection after attempting to self-induce an abortion. The death of this patient weighed heavily on Sanger's soul. She stayed up all night, unable to stop thinking of the injustice of it all. It would set her on a path to become one of the world's leading medical pioneers in contraception and sexual health. In 1912, Sanger started writing a column for the New York Call, a left-wing daily newspaper in which she dispensed advice about sexual health and contraception. 2 years later, she began publishing The Woman Rebel, a feminist journal that primarily advocated better contraception and a woman's right to choose. "I believed it was my duty to place motherhood on a higher level than enslavement and accident," she said. Just a few months later, the Comstock Act came crashing down on her head. Sanger was indicted on 9 counts of sending birth control-related material through the post. But she didn't wait around to be sent to prison. The day before her trial, she fled the country and made for Europe. In the Netherlands, she visited a family planning clinic and was convinced by the effectiveness of the diaphragm. When the charges against her were dropped in 1916, she returned to set up the first birth control clinic in Brooklyn, New York. Her dream of a network of centers that offered a range of contraceptive services was later realized when she set up the American Birth Control League in 1921, now known as Planned Parenthood, and made its mission global with the 1952 formation of the International Planned Parenthood Foundation. She was also involved behind the scenes in scientific research, supporting and raising funds for newer and more advanced contraceptive methods, efforts that eventually led to the creation of the pill. Over her lifetime, Sanger was arrested, hounded out of her own country, and even threatened with jail for what she believed in. But she lived to see her life's work vindicated. In 1965, a year before she died, the U.S. Supreme Court ruled that a state contraception ban violated the right to privacy, thereby legalizing birth control. She never lost faith that the country would come around to her belief that contraceptive choice would mean freeing women from the cycle of childbirth and poverty. "I was convinced we must care about people. We must reach out to help them in their despair. For these beliefs, I was denounced, arrested. I was in and out of police courts and higher courts, and indictments hung over my life for several years. But nothing could alter my beliefs. Because I saw these as truths, I stubbornly stuck to my convictions. Jesse Redman Fawcett. In 1924, Livewright Publishing hailed a brand new voice in African-American literature. There's something new under the sun, and it is There Is Confusion. It was a novel from Jesse Redman Fawcett, 1882 to 1961, about the struggles of middle and upper-class black people. It earned her comparisons to Edith Wharton, and she was later described as the Black Jane Austen. With four novels and countless editorials and articles in The Crisis, W.E.B. Du Bois magazine affiliated to the NAACP, National Association for the Advancement of Colored People, Jesse didn't just live through the explosion of black art and culture that was the Harlem Renaissance. In the words of Langston Hughes, she midwifed it into being. All she wanted, she maintained, was to portray the breathing spells in between spaces where colored men and women work and love. Jesse was born in New Jersey in 1882. As the book-smart daughter of a Methodist reverend, Jesse was sent to Philadelphia High School for Girls, where her stellar grades earned her a scholarship to Cornell University. After she got her bachelor's degree from Cornell as its first black graduate, Jesse, armed with flawless French, went on to get a master's degree in Romance languages from the University of Pennsylvania. Jobs, however, were not forthcoming. She had to move several times over, from Philadelphia to Baltimore and then to Washington, D.C., to find employment in teaching her chosen field. When she successfully placed a few poems and short stories in The Crisis, however, Du Bois was impressed enough to offer her the New York-based job of literary editor. In 1919, Jesse packed her bags and departed the capital for Harlem. In Plum Bun, Jesse's second novel, published in 1928, her light-skinned and white-passing protagonist Angela Murray makes a similar journey, leaving Philly behind to pursue life as an artist in Greenwich Village. She describes New York as a city of two visages. It could offer an aspect radiant with promise, or a countenance lowering and forbidding. Luckily, Jessie found the former when she moved with her sister into West 142nd Street. She turned their apartment into one of the best-known literary salons of the time, where the intellectuals, artists, and activists of the Harlem Renaissance mixed and mingled. Jesse used her powerful position as literary editor to support and mentor then-emerging writers like Langston Hughes and Jean Toomer. In fact, Jesse published Hughes's very first poem. He remarked of her innumerable soirées, "There was always quite a different atmosphere from that of most other Harlem good time gatherings. White people were seldom present there unless they were very distinguished white people. Because Jessie Fawcett did not feel like opening her home to mere sightseers or faddists momentarily in love with Negro life." Jessie continued to write for The Crisis, contributing poems, short stories, and a novella, publishing several biographies of notable black figures, and working with Du Bois on The Brownies Book, a magazine for black children. "It is urgent that ambitious Negro youth be able to read of the achievements of their race," she said. "When I was a child, I used to puzzle my head ruefully over the fact that in school we studied the lives of only great white people. I took it that there simply have been no great Negroes, and I was amazed when, as I grew older, I found that there were. It is a pity that Negro children should be permitted to suffer from that delusion at all." Jesse's pen shaped The Crisis in other non-literary ways. She filed travel essays from her travels through post-World War I France and Italy, and reports from the Pan-African Congress of 1921. "We clasped hands with our newly found brethren and departed," she wrote glowingly of the conference, "feeling that it was good to be alive and most wonderful to be coloured." By 1926, however, she had fallen out with Dubois at the crisis. At the time, her boss was in debt to her to the tune of $2,500 and hadn't paid up. Worse still, she felt that the magazine was moving away from cultural content and sidelining her literary coverage. A notice in the May issue of that year announced she was stepping down as literary editor to take a contributing editor role instead. When Jessie sought work in publishing elsewhere, she couldn't find a company willing to take her on. If her race was a factor, she said, she could work from home, but she struggled to find anyone to take her up on the offer. Jessie returned to teaching. Her next two books were less well received, and by the 1930s, her work was considered too stiff and formal, its concerns too bourgeois and middle class. Yet she always held true to her maxim that there were, and always would be, those who would welcome her words. "Here is an audience waiting to hear the truth about us," she said in 1932, of being a black author writing for a black audience. "Let us, who are better qualified to present that truth than any white writer, try to do so." The Radium Girls. In the early part of the 20th century, one element was all the rage: radium. Thought to be a miracle cure for every ailment going, the newly discovered element was used in everything, from lotions and toothpaste to drinking water. Even the US military had a use for it. Radium made the clock faces of their soldiers' timepieces glow gently enough to be seen in the dark, yet remain undetected by enemy troops. Young women and teenage girls were employed in US Radium Corporation factories as dial painters, tasked with the delicate job of painting radium on the watches and clocks. They were instructed to wet the brushes in their mouths to make the finest point necessary for painting radium on with, a practice known as lip pointing. They were told by their employers that radium was safe, but nothing could have been farther from the truth. With every passing day in the factory and every dab of the brush in the mouth, they were ingesting a toxic substance. Radium may have lit their skin, hair, and clothes with a beautiful, unearthly glow, but it was killing them from the inside. In 1922, Amelia Molly Maggia quit the factory. She'd worked there for 4 years, but now she was wasting away from a mysterious disease. One by one, she lost her teeth. Her jaw literally broke off into pieces. Her limbs ached with what was initially diagnosed as rheumatism. She eventually hemorrhaged to death. Amelia wasn't the only dial painter who fell sick. Catherine Schaub's teeth fell out, and Grace Fryer had to wear a steel brace to support her back. Even after they stopped working at the factory, their bones fractured easily and their jaws crumbled. Cancerous tumors sprouted on their bodies. Five dying women, Catherine, Grace, Edna Boltz, and Amelia's two sisters, tried to take US Radium to court. The press christened them the Radium Girls. It wasn't easy, though. Their former employers had no desire to admit wrongdoing, and the women struggled to find a lawyer to take their case. But Harrison Martland, a New Jersey medical examiner, and New York City toxicologist Alexander Gettler soon discovered that Amelia's exhumed remains were poisoned with radiation. It proved the Radium Girls were right. the radioactive element in their bodies was causing them to sicken and, in the case of 13 other women since the lawsuit had been filed, die. By the time the radium girls saw US radium in the courtroom, they too were dying. But they were motivated by other reasons. "It is not for myself I care," Grace declared. "I am thinking more of the hundreds of girls to whom this may serve as an example." After all, another dial painting factory had just opened up in Illinois. Dozens more girls might be exposed to the same levels of radium that were killing them. The radium girls sued the company for $250,000 each, a huge sum by today's standards. They won damages in 1938, but were given only months to live. Catherine Donahue, a worker in Illinois who sued her company Radium Dial, gave testimony while bedridden on a sofa. Although these women ended up winning their cases, they faced resistance at every turn. Still, they refused to give up and eventually paved the way for what American workers now take for granted, that companies can be held legally responsible for the safety and health of their employees, and that people have the guaranteed right to work in a safe environment. Tsjeng. In the early 1940s, Shanghai, once known as the Paris of Asia, was ruled by danger and uncertainty. Its glamorous boulevards were under the control of Japan, and locals had been forced to swap socializing and Art Deco hotels for food shortages and air raids. But the Chinese writer Tsjeng, described by one peer as a Luanshi Jiaren, a beauty at a turbulent time, didn't just find a way to endure these times, she thrived. Tsjeng, 1914 to 1982, had always dreamed of getting an education. She was only a freshman at the National Zhongyang University when her parents forced her to drop out and enter an arranged marriage with a man to whom she had been promised when she was 14. The unhappy relationship lasted for 10 years before Tsjeng filed for separation, taking her two children with her. She entered Japanese-occupied Shanghai society as that rare thing, a divorcee. She was determined to make a living the best way she knew how: writing. Tsjeng's essays, short stories, and novels boldly set out to break down conservative gender norms and critique the familial and social forces that had yanked her out of school and yoked her to a man she didn't love. Her efforts won her the admiration of her contemporaries and all of Shanghai. In 1943, she founded her own literary journal, Heaven and Earth Monthly, and the accompanying Heaven and Earth Press as a publishing house, the first of its kind run by a young female author. It wasn't long before Tsjeng was spoken of in the same breath as the city's greatest actresses and idols, feted in the tabloids and profiled in magazines. "Some people asked me why I had to write in this war-trodden era," she said in one postscript to a collection of essays. "Their way of thinking is just the contrary to mine. I know only too well that everything is going to collapse soon, but I still hope to grasp this moment and seek serenity and fulfillment right away. Otherwise, what am I going to do with these few surviving moments? I want to live, and I want to live in a way that most satisfies myself." In 1944, she published her first book, Jiehun Qinyan, 10 Years of Marriage, and became a cause célèbre. The semi-autobiographical novel begins on the day of the protagonist's arranged marriage and unspools from there, laying out the various indignities and frustrations of her relationship, including having to pee on her own pillow as she is barred from leaving her bed until the bridal sedan arrives. Its dark humour was a stark contrast to the usual overwrought confessional novels of the time, and the best-selling book made her one of Shanghai's most popular writers, but not without controversy. One newspaper branded it pornographic, and a women's magazine accused Tsjeng of being a literary prostitute bent on enslaving the minds of Shanghai women and numbing their consciousness of resistance, making people forget oppression and the bloodiness of reality. There were vicious rumors swirling around Tsjeng, too, that she secretly supported the Japanese, and that her career was bankrolled by the mayor of Shanghai, who was later executed as a collaborator. That same year, she wrote an essay entitled Zhizhe de Fangjian, My Own Room, that considered the indignities she endured just for the sin of trying to provide for her own children. I look around me. I bought everything, even the nails in this room, with my own money, she wrote. However, what joy can I have in this fact? When the Japanese occupation came to an end, Tsjeng's connections to the regime, however tenuous, were enough to torpedo her career. Publishers refused to go near her work, and she had to resort to writing under a pseudonym. Once the communists took over in 1949, Tsjeng managed to find work as a dramatist for local opera and theatre groups under the pen name Feng Yongshuang, writing historical dramas or adapting traditional Chinese stories for the stage. In 1955, however, she was arrested on charges of counter-revolutionary behaviour. She had strayed from her job as a faceless Ministry of Culture-approved scriptwriter to write essays for the Shanghai Daily in Hong Kong. Tsjeng had stopped short of criticising the regime. She was too smart for that. But her gentle critique of the new China proved too much for the authorities. That, combined with her old reputation as a sympathizer and her ties to Hu Feng, a literary critic and outspoken critic of Mao, was enough to get her writing banned completely and send her to prison for 2 years. By the time she was released, the name of Tsjeng had faded into obscurity. She died in poverty at the age of 68. In Waves, a short story published in 1945, Tsjeng seemed to catch a glimpse of the tumult that lay ahead. Life is like the sea, she wrote, a vast expanse when calm, aimless, even stymied. Yet when all of a sudden the waves start surging, roaring and unstoppable, that's just the way it is. It's not up to you anymore. You've just got to roll with it. And then the wind stops and the waves die down, and what's left is that vast expanse once more, all worn out, the crashing waves mere memory. Doria Shafiq. When Doria Shafiq, 1908 to 1975, was sentenced to house arrest at the age of 48, poetry and literature became her escape. She spent the next 18 years sequestered in her sixth-floor apartment in Cairo. Egypt's pioneering activist faded from public memory until her 1975 suicide reignited her status as the country's most ambitious and tragically thwarted women's rights campaigner. Doria was born into a middle-class Egyptian family in 1908, at a time of unique transition. Women were still expected to marry after receiving minimal schooling, but Doria had the luck and the will to fight for her education. At 19, she sailed from Alexandria to France, where she dived into her studies at the Sorbonne. Europe was both a revelation and a shock. At the International House in Paris, a sort of dormitory for women students, she met women from many other countries, from Martinique to Morocco and Greece, and began to refine her understanding of the torment and prejudice experienced by her gender. I realized that my country was not the only place where women suffered, she wrote of her time there. We each had the experience of being misunderstood in our own countries, being intellectually more ambitious than our countrymen. Completing the licence libre and the licence d'état was not easy. The two were separate degrees, and one required Doria to quickly learn Latin, a language of which she previously had no knowledge. Still, Doria pulled it off. A few years later, she would successfully defend her doctorate with a thesis that argued the link between women's rights and Islam. But Doria was no bookish recluse. While back home for the holidays, she competed in the Miss Universe heats in Alexandria. I wanted to amuse myself a little, she told a French reporter with a smile. She was the first Egyptian Muslim woman to enter the competition and came second to a contestant who would later go on to become Miss Universe. The Egyptian press, which had previously celebrated her as a national figure of educational achievement, turned nasty and accused her of acting in an un-Islamic fashion. But Doria saw no contradiction between participating in a beauty contest and her religious or political beliefs. In Paris, she said, I had asserted myself in the intellectual sphere. Now I wanted to assert myself in the feminine sphere. When Doria, armed with her doctorate, finally returned to Egypt for good, her application for a teaching job at the University of Cairo was rejected. The damning assessment, too modern. But Egypt had changed while Doria was in Paris. Now political upheaval was in the air. Though Britain had granted independence to its former protectorate in 1922, there was simmering discontent with the lingering presence of British imperialism. Doria firmly believed that women had a key part to play in Egypt's struggle for liberation, and that feminism would help both genders get there. Feminism, she wrote in an essay in 1944, in the true sense of the word, is the total comprehension between man and woman, not a perpetual fight between the two sexes. When she was offered a job as the editor-in-chief of La Femme Nouvelle, a French-language magazine associated with Princess Chevikar, the powerful wife of King Fuad, she leaped at the chance to explore these ideas on a larger literary platform. But it would also place her in direct opposition to mainstream political sentiment, which saw the monarchy as an out-of-touch relic on the side of the British. Undeterred, Doria's solution to satisfying her critics was to start a more political magazine, this time in Arabic, Bint al-Nil, Daughter of the Nile. As Egyptian society splintered between the Muslim Brotherhood, the communists, and the military, Doria became convinced that the country needed to pass legislation that would allow women to vote and run for office. Women must not only be present when laws concerning them are legislated, they must be involved in writing them, she argued, by demanding the totality of her rights, particularly her political rights, which are the very basis of all rights, the woman could bring about fundamental changes in society. She founded the Bint al-Nil Union, announcing it as a new movement that would bring about emancipation for all Egyptian women. In February 1951, she led a group of almost 1,500 women to the gates of the Egyptian parliament to issue a series of demands, including universal suffrage. Over the next few months, Egyptians took to the streets to rage against the monarchy and the government, leading to riots and the 1952 military coup that overthrew the regime. Doria was ecstatic at the hope of change and turned Bint al-Nil into a political party. Women, she thought, would finally carve out their place in the newly declared Egyptian Republic. The next few years were a bitter disappointment. As the military junta cracked down on dissent, the all-male ruling party began to draw up a new constitution without promising any political rights to women. With a group of 8 women, Doria went on hunger strike in protest. The reaction was explosive. Doria and her group were hailed as 20th century suffragettes in the international media. 8 days into the hunger strike, and under the glare of the world's press, the new government relented. Women would be allowed full constitutional rights in the new Egypt. Post-hunger strike, Doria was an international celebrity and embarked on a lecture tour around the world. But back in Egypt, President Gamal Abdel Nasser was consolidating his authority and weeding out opposition. And Doria, with her newfound links to the West, was an object of suspicion. On her return, Doria staged a second hunger strike to protest the encroaching dictatorship of her country. It was to be her final lone act of public protest. She was widely denounced in Egypt, and even her old supporters were terrified of speaking out. Nasser gave women the right to vote, but Doria did not reap the benefits of women's entry into public life. In 1957, Nasser condemned her to house arrest and blacklisted her name in the press. Her own political party expelled her, and she was branded a traitor to the revolution. Even after the government informally lifted her house arrest, she remained indoors. The betrayal of her allies and her countrymen had stung too much. She spent almost 20 years in near total isolation, with only visits from family to break her solitude. She was 66 when she tumbled from the balcony of her apartment, her death reawakening public consciousness of this once ubiquitous public figure.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.